Good morning, boys and girls. Myself, Dr. Ramesh Chandra, Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmacology. And I'll be taking your class today. Before that, I would like to congratulate you on coming to second MBBS. So today's topic is the routes of drug administration. So let's see what are the different routes of drug administration. So the major routes of drug administration are enteral routes, parenteral routes, you know, and then topical routes. So major routes of drug administration are enteral routes. So enteral routes, we have got oral, sublingual, and then rectal routes. So as I told you, we have enteral routes, parenteral routes, and then topical routes. So enteral routes, there are oral, sublingual, and rectal. Parenteral routes, intravenous, intramuscular, intraperitoneal, intrathecal, intramedullary, intraarticular, intraarterial, subcutaneous, intracardiac, epidural. And then B, we have inhalation administration and transdermal administration. And then we have topical routes, conjunctival, nasal and auditory mucosal, vaginal and urethral, and junction and dermal. So these are the major routes of drug administration. Now let's see enteral routes, oral, sublingual, and rectal. So these are enteral routes, oral, sublingual, and rectal. These are parenteral routes, injections, intravenous, intramuscular, intraperitoneal, intrathecal, intramedullary, intraarterial, intraarticular, subcutaneous, intracardiac, epidural, inhalational, transdermal. And then topical routes, conjunctival, vaginal, urethral, junction, and dermal. So enteral routes, as you can see in the picture, the drug is placed directly to any part of the gastrointestinal tract, be it from mouth to rectum. So oral administration. So the site is swallowing of a drug through the mouth is oral administration. So enteral route, placement of a drug directly to any part of the gastrointestinal tract. Oral administration, the site, swallowing of a drug through the mouth. So advantages. This is the most commonly used method. So easy to take the drug into the mouth. Safe, convenient, painless procedure. Even a layman can take it. Moreover, it is economical. And moreover, it is economical as well as sterilization of the drug is not essential as well. Sterilization of the drug is not essential, although. So disadvantages, let's see this. Slower onset of action and absorption is sometimes erratic, or absorption may be slow. Highly polar compounds like aminoglycosides and quaternary salts like D-tuberculin are not absorbed through this route. And hence they cannot give orally to provide systemic effects. They are not given or to give any systemic effects. Drugs that are destroyed by digestive juices like penicillin G, insulin cannot be administered by this route. Drugs having first pass effect like morphine are not preferred because they are destroyed by the liver enzymes. And palliative of drugs is also essential. So taste also plays a role here. So whenever you take these drugs, sometimes they may have nauseating effects. So you feel like throwing the drug out. So palatability of drug is also essential. So there are slower onset of action and absorption is erratic. Highly polar compounds and quaternary salts are not absorbed. Drugs that are destroyed by digestive juices like penicillin G, insulin cannot be administered by this route. And drugs having first pass effect, those destroyed in liver before reaching the systemic effect, before system circulation are not preferred. And palatability of drugs is also essential. Drugs cannot be given in these drugs. The oral route cannot be given in unconscious and uncooperative patients. Patients having nausea and vomiting can also be not given by this route. Example, almost all the drugs, be it tablet, like any you name it, it is there. Tablet syrups are usually given orally. They provide systemic effects mainly. Few provide local effects like antacids and anti-diarrheal drugs. So almost whatever the drugs we take in day in, day out are usually given orally. So let's see sublingual. So site, the drug is placed beneath the tongue. The tongue is placed between the tongue or crushed in mouth and spread over the buccal mucosa. As you can see in the picture, the tongue is being placed beneath the trunk. This is sublingual route of administration. Advantages. So quick onset of action, rapid absorption through buccal or sublingual mucus, rapid drug passes directly to systemic circulation. So after absorption, the drug passes directly to systemic circulation, thus bypassing the portal circulation, thus avoiding first pass degradation. So the drug directly passes systemic circulation, bypassing the first pass metabolism. The drug can be spitted out if side effects are observed. So advantages are, it has got quick onset of action, rapid absorption through the buccal or sublingual mucosa membrane. Directly passes the drug directly passes through systemic circulation, bypassing the first pass effect. And the drug can be spitted out if side effects are observed. So disadvantages. Distasteful irritant drugs cannot be given. High molecular compounds or high molecular weight drugs are not well absorbed. Example, isosorbate dinitrate tablets for angina. For hypertensive patients, we have got uncontrolled hypertension or if there is sudden rise in hypertension, nifedipine capsule can be placed beneath the tongue. So useful for treating hypertension. This would mainly provide systemic effects except antiseptic lozenges. Disadvantages are distasteful, irritant drugs cannot be given. High molecular weight drugs not well absorbed. Example, isosorbate dinitrate tablet for angina and nifedipine capsules for hypertension. So this would mainly provide systemic effects except antiseptic lozenges. Rectal. So the route of administration of drug is through the rectum. So the drug is placed in the rectum. As you can see the picture, the drug is being placed in the rectum. So advantages can be useful for patients having nausea and vomiting. So those who cannot take the drug through the mouth or through the sublingual, so this is one of the preferred routes. So the drug is placed in the rectum. And let's see the advantages. So it is more useful in patients having nausea and vomiting. You can bypass the first pass metabolism, or is first pass metabolism relatively less, and it is more or less useful for gastric irritant drugs. So it can be useful for patients having nausea and vomiting. Advantages, first pass metabolism is relatively very less and useful for gastric irritant drugs. So disadvantages. As you are placing the drug in the rectum, so there is some amount of rectal inflammation. The absorption is unreliable. You may not know how much the drug is absorbed, and it is moreover inconvenient and embarrassing to the patient. So patient may not cooperate that easily, since you know it is not the preferred route of administration of drug. So the patient sometimes feels inconvenient, and they may feel embarrassing too as well. So example for local effects. So if at all you're having constipation, drugs like Dalcolex or soap water enema or some ointments for other purposes can be applied or, you know, placed in the rectum. For systemic effects like diazepam rectal suppository can be used. So let's see what are the parenteral routes of drug administration. So routes other than enteral, par means aside. Aside, it's a Greek word, aside. So par, aside of enteral. Aside more other than enteral routes. So we have injections which provide fast systemic effect and they bypass first pass metabolism. So because of this, you may have 100% of availability of the drug. So the availability will be 100%. So these injections, they provide fast systemic effect. And they also bypass first pass metabolism. Intravenous administration. So as you can see, the drug is being given into the veins, through the lumen of the veins, mainly anticubital vein. So intravenous administration through the lumen of the veins, mainly anticubital vein. Advantages: drug enters the systemic circulation directly, bypassing first pass metabolism, as I told you before. So the drug is bypassing the first pass metabolism. So whenever it happens, there is 100% bioavailability. So the drug is available at the desired site of action. So quick onset of action, less dose is required. So lesser dose is required to achieve desired plasma concentration. So it is available therapy in emergency conditions, can be administered in unconscious, can be administered in unconscious and uncooperative patients are having nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. And then GIT retains and hypertonic solutions can be infused. Amounts of drug can be controlled. Large volume of fluids can be infused at a uniform rate by this route. So like IV fluids, suppose a patient comes to you in shock, so you can infuse them larger volumes of IV fluids like that. So advantage of this route are drug enters systemic circulation directly bypassing first pass metabolism. So thereby you will achieve 100% availability or bioavailability. So it has got quick onset of action, less doses required to achieve desired plasma concentration. It's a valuable therapy in emergency conditions, can be administered to unconscious or uncontrolled or uncooperative patients or patients having nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. So GIT retains and hypertonic solutions can be infused. Large volume of fluids can be infused at a uniform rate by this route. So as in case of shock or whatever conditions. So amount for the drug can be controlled by this route of administration. So let's see on the other aspect, on the other side of the coin, disadvantages. So need to administer the drug in strict aseptic conditions. Patient has to depend on somebody for giving an injection, maybe an expertise or a medical personnel. Painful and risky because once the drug is injected, it cannot be recalled or recontrolled. Introduction, it cannot be recalled. Introduction of any particulate matter or air may produce embolism. Oily and suspension drugs cannot be administered by this route. Oily or suspension drugs cannot be administered by this route. So there is a possibility of development of venous thrombosis and thromboplebitis and necrosis around the site of injection. Example, normal saline, any IV fluids, dopamine, many antibiotics. So almost every antibiotic or any drug can be given by this route. The route provides mainly systemic effects. Intramuscular injection. So as you can see, the drug is being given into the deltoid region of the muscle, of the deltoid region of the hand. So the site is deltoid muscle, gluteus or vastus muscle of the lateral aspect of the thigh. It also serves as a route for administration of the drug. So absorption is more predictable, less variable and rapid. So absorption is predictable, less variable and rapid. Depot injections can be given. So absorption is more predictable, less variable and rapid. Depot injections can be given. Advantages. So strict asymptomatic conditions are needed. Chances of abscess at the site of injection is possible. Chance of nerve damage leading to paresis of muscle supplied by it is also possible. Large volume cannot be administered. So more than 5 ml cannot give by IM route. Example, antibiotics, antiemetics, antipod injection, testosterone. Any drugs, painful drugs, antacid, ranitidine or diclofenac, or paracetamol can be given by this route. Provides mainly systemic effects. So intraperitoneal administration. So site, it is directly given into the peritoneal space. So advantages, rapid absorption due to larger surface area. Disadvantages, so just like other conditions, here also you need to follow asymptomatic conditions or aseptic conditions are needed. It is painful, risky due to chance of additions and infections. Example, for administering dialysis fluids in case of poisoning. So it is mainly administered for dialysis fluids in case of poisoning and renal failure. Most commonly used for administering drugs in laboratory animals. So disadvantages are aseptic conditions are needed, painful, risky due to chance of additional infections. Example are for administering dialysis fluids in case of poison renal failure, for administering drugs in laboratory animals. Intrathecal or intraspinal. So the drug is introduced into the subarachnoid space. So advantages, as you can see here, the drug is being introduced to the arachnoid space. Subarachnoid space, the drug after diffusing from the lumbar sac pass into the subarachnoid space bypassing the blood-brain barrier as well as blood CSF barrier. Thus, significant CSF levels are provided which otherwise are not possible by other routes. So the drug directly after diffusing from the lumbar sac pass into the subarachnoid space bypassing the blood-brain barrier as well as blood CSF barrier. The drug directly acts on the meninges and on the spinal cord. So let's see the disadvantages. Strict asymptomatic or aseptic conditions are required and a great expertise is needed. It's rather a painful and risky procedure. So example, lignocaine injection for spinal anesthesia, and it mainly provides local effects. Certain antibiotics used to treat meningitis to provide systemic effects. So disadvantage, strict aseptic conditions and great expertise is required. This is rather painful and risky condition, a risky procedure. So example, lignocaine injection for spinal anesthesia mainly provides local effects. Certain antibiotics used to treat meningitis to provide systemic effects are used. So intramedullary administration, site, injection of the drug into the tibial or sternal bone marrow. So advantages, it has got very quick onset of action, or the onset of action is very fast. So onset of action is very fast as the vascular space of bone marrow communicate directly with the larger veins. So disadvantages, risky and a painful procedure. Strict aseptic conditions are needed. Example, for bone marrow transplantation mainly provides systemic effects. Intra-arterial administration. So the drug is introduced into the lumen of the desired artery. Advantages, greater concentration of the drug can be delivered at the desired site of action. So the disadvantages are greater expertise in asymptomatic conditions or aseptic conditions are needed. Example, radio opaque contrast media for coronary as well as cerebral angiography. So mainly provides local effects on the area supplied by the injected artery. Intra-articular. So the site is directly the drug is injected into the joint space. So advantages are ensures higher concentration of drug in a localized area. But disadvantages, strict aseptic conditions are required. Repeated administration of the drug may further damage the joint, and it is rather painful. example, steroids injection for rheumatoid arthritis, as like hydrocortisone or tricot, and they provide local effects. Subcutaneous administration. So the site is injection into the subcutaneous tissue under the skin. So advantages, smooth but slower absorption for a longer period. As you can see in the picture, the drug is being injected to the subcutaneous tissue under the skin. So advantages being, they are smooth but slower absorption for a longer period. Depot injections or implants can also be made. So disadvantage being, only small amount or volume of drug. So per se, 1 ml can be administered. Irritant drugs cannot be administered. Not suitable in case of shock. So it is not suitable in case of shock, as there is reduced peripheral circulation, thereby decrease the rate of absorption. So example, local anesthetics for local effects, insulin for systemic effects, and vaccines can also be administered by this route of administration. So intradermal, the site B, the drug is injected into the outer layers of the skin, as you can see in the picture. Small amount of drug can be given and absorption is slow. Example, BCG vaccine for allergics and say test in patients, as in for penicillin or some antibiotics, can also be done by this route. So injected into the outer layers of skin, small amount of drug can be given and absorption is slow. So example, BCG vaccine and allergic sensation test in patients. So dermojets. It is a subcutaneous needleless injection of a drug through a micro-fined orifice. It's a rather painful procedure. So it is a subcutaneous, dermojets are subcutaneous needleless injections of a drug through a micro-fined orifice. So painful, painless procedure. It is a rather painless procedure. And it is useful for mass inoculation. So pellets and biodegradable implants. The drug has a solid pellet or a pack in a biodegradable tubes, is implanted under the skin. Provides a uniform but a slow release of the drug lasting over months. Example, testosterone and contraceptive implants for systemic effects. Epidural injection. The site, the drug is injected through a vertebral interspace between the dura of the spinal cord and the lining of the spinal cord. Over here, the drug is being injected through a vertebral interspace between the dura of the spinal cord and the lining of the spinal cord. Example, lignocaine injection to provide epidural nerve block for local effect. So intracardiac injection. So the injection is given by long needle through the into the heart through the left fourth intercostal space close to the sternum. So example, this is mainly done in case of a cardiogenic shock or the person who has gone into cardiac arrest. So the drug adrenaline is injected into the heart in a case of sudden cardiac arrest for local effect. So injection of adrenaline to restart the heart in a case of sudden cardiac arrest for local effect. So inhalational administration. So the site, inspiration through nose or mouth. So what happens here? There is faster absorption, quick onset of action because of larger surface area of the alveoli. So fast absorption and quick onset because of larger surface of the alveoli. Self-administration is possible. Anyone can take, even a layman can take it. So examples are, so disadvantages, there may be bronchial irritation leading to increased bronchial as well as salivary secretions. Example, oxygen, general anesthetic inhalation for systemic effects, metered dose inhaler for asthma, for local effects. So these are a couple of examples. So disadvantages being, they cause bronchial irritation. Apart from that, there is increased bronchial secretion, bronchial and salivary secretions. So oxygen generosity, inhalation for systemic effects, meter dose inhalers for asthma for local effect. Couple of examples. So transdermal administration, transdermal patches. Applied topically provides systemic effects, as you can see in the picture. So advantages being slow but sustained release of the drug for several days. It bypasses the first pass metabolism. So disadvantages, irritation. So irritation, sometimes they are rather very less. Disadvantages less. However, if irritation is there, that the site of application can be changed. Example, nitroglycerin for angina, scopolamine for motion sickness, and clonidine for hypertension. So third one, topical routes of administration of drugs. So it's first one is conjunctival, nasal, and oral mucosal. So ointments are isotonic aqueous solutions of drugs like gentamicin, ciprofloxacin applied or instilled onto the conjunctiva for local effect. So here, ointments are isotonic aqueous solutions of drugs like gentamicin, ciprofloxacin, gatifloxacin, gemcitabine, all these antibiotics are applied or instilled onto the conjunctiva for local effects. So drugs can also be administered as nasal drops, nasal sprays, or as ear drops. So absorption through the mucus membrane can lead to systemic effects. So vaginal and urethral solutions, ointments, tablets, suppositories, antifungal drugs, metronidazole are used for local application to the vagina. Drug solutions and pencil-shaped pouches are available for urethral use. Inunction and dermal site. So inunction and dermal, the site, rubbing the drug preparation onto the skin or can be tested or sprayed over the surface of the skin. Advantages, it is the most safe and convenient method of administration of drug. Disadvantages being difficulty in ascertaining the amount of drug absorbed. Systemic absorption may take place if the skin has abrasions. Example, various lotions, creams, and ointments for the antiseptic as well as analgesic effects only. So, till now, we have seen the routes of different routes of drug administration, enteral, parenteral, as well as topical routes. So, in enteral, we have seen oral, sublingual, and rectal. Parenteral, we have seen down from intravenous to epidural, and then inhalation administration, transdermal administration. And then we have discussed about topical routes in brief as well. We have discussed about the advantages as well as disadvantages. So now let's compare and contrast between enteral as well as parenteral routes of administration. So enteral, they are administered via gastrointestinal tract. So I've discussed earlier, they are mainly oral, sublingual, and rectal. And then parenteral, administered through routes like injection, topical application to skin, or by inhalational lungs. So here, what are the different routes you are supposed to write over here? What are different routes in parenteral? So enteral, they are administered mainly through oral, sublingual, and rectal, and administered through routes like injection or through topical application to skin, or by inhalational through lungs. So these are more safe and convenient as much when compared to parenteral administration. Asepsis or asymptomatic conditions are required for administration of parenteral drugs. It is a non-invasive technique, enteral, whereas needs an expertise, parenteral administration needs an expertise. So it is self-medication is possible. Self-medication can be difficult. So difficult to administer orally in unconscious and uncooperative patients. Enteral routes, it is rather difficult to administer in an unconscious and uncooperative patients. So parenteral, it's rather an emergency condition, can be used in emergency therapy when a patient is unconscious, uncooperative, or unable to retain anything given by mouth. Parenteral therapy can be useful. So enteral administration, limited absorption when given through oral route because of So limited absorption will be given through oral route. So what happens here? The drug undergoes first pass metabolism. The drug has to pass through the liver. So first pass metabolism. So there is decreased bioavailability. So there is limited absorption. So there is the drug is the absorption by the absorption of the drug is decreased. So there is decreased bioavailability. On the other hand, on the contrary, in parenteral routes, availability is usually more rapid, extensive, and predictable when a drug is given by injection. So what happens here? It surpasses or it bypasses the first pass metabolism, and there is 100% bioavailability. So enteral route of administration may cause gastric irritation. Sometimes the patient may vomit. So there is irritation to the gastric mucosa, intergastrointestinal mucosa. The need for cooperation on the part of the patient is, so there is need for cooperation on the part of the patient. These are a couple of compare and contrast between enteral and parenteral routes of administration. So here in parenteral, you don't need cooperation of the patient. Even if unconscious, patient can be administered by this route of administration. So till now, we have seen the different routes of administration, enteral, parenteral, and then topical. We have discussed their site of administration, as well as we have discussed the advantages and disadvantages and the drugs which will be given by these routes. So I hope you understood. And before I conclude my class, I just want to tell you, stay home, stay safe, and don't go out. Bye.